Welcome everybody to In Isolation With. It's the talk show where we make a connection without actually making contact. I hope you're all feeling well, that you're all safe and happy wherever you may be. A little bit later on, we'll meet the comedian and actor Sean Cullen. He's one of the stars of the new Netflix animated film, The Willoughbys, and he stopped by, well, remotely stopped by, to talk about how Full Metal Jacket influenced his comedy and why he hates Mrs. Doubtfire. Before we get to Sean, though, I wanted to share this with you. Like so many of us, I've been spending probably just a little bit too much time on social media. It's a good time waster. I don't know if it's a good time waster, but it is a time waster. And I came across a tweet that I thought was quite funny from Jennifer Tilly. She says, "Isolation Journal, Day 42. Things I've learned during quarantine. Pretty much everything can go in the washing machine." Now, I have a couple of rules when it comes to social media. One of them is that I don't at celebrities. They don't want to hear from me. But the Jennifer Tilly tweet kind of made me laugh, and I had just seen a story about people cleaning their fruits and vegetables in a dishwasher. I had never heard that before. I know that during the pandemic, we're supposed to be cleaning everything that comes into the house, but that, I thought, took it one step too far. So I sent that to her. I asked if she had ever done it, and she replied that she thought it was a good idea. And if Jennifer Tilly thinks it's a good idea, I do too. Although I don't really see myself washing my lemons and limes in the dishwasher anytime soon. Now let's get to know Sean Cullen.
How are you making up?
Well, it's all right. You know, I'm kind of a homebody anyway, so I don't mind it that much, but it's getting a little tiring. I'm just getting to the point where I'm bored sitting in, and you get up in the morning and you go, well, what am I doing today? Pretty much nothing. Yeah. But I've done this thing called the COVID-19 Online Comedy Fest.
I love it. I've had so much fun watching these and sharing them. It's fantastic. And I thought that it was a really interesting way of adapting to what is now our normal.
Yeah, well, I can't perform for people. Mm-hmm. I can't go out to them. When the cancellation came in, I was doing the Kingston Canadian Film Festival. And as you know, I'm in a film called The 20th Century. Brilliant. Matthew Rankin's first feature that's been nominated for CSAs and was best first feature at TIFF. So they were doing it at the, they were area showing it at the Kingston Canadian Film Festival. So I drove down to Kingston on the 12th of March, got there, did my sound check, and then they said, you can go home now because the entire film festival's canceled. Wow. So I drove back home. And on the way home, I thought, oh, I've got to do something. This is going to be a problem, you know, and people are going to be in their homes. So I thought, well, I don't have a lot of marketable skills, really. I can't save lives, but I can make people a little less bored. So four times a day, I do posts on the COVID-19 Online Comedy Fest on my Twitter and Facebook and Instagram. And so people have responded well to it. I haven't gotten any, you know, cease and desist emails yet. So it's all good.
Well, I looked it up today. And I was met with Batocular Articulation was the headline that I saw today. And it's very funny.
Oh, good. Well, yeah. I'm just running, you know, I'm running out of things to talk about. So I've gotten down to my buttock muscles and their articulate abilities. And so today I was thinking of, I don't get a lot of fitness opportunities stuck in the house. So I'm getting naked, covering myself with olive oil, and getting in the tub and trying to get out without using my hands or arms, which is a great core workout. And then I'm using my buttocks to manipulate things, catch balls, crush bits of whatever I can find. Walnuts, crush nuts, and also paint portraits of famous historical leaders. So it's been fun.
It's been fun. I think my favorite thing that's come out of the COVID comedy, what's it called? I just want to make sure we get it right here, and I'll put it up so people can find it. The COVID-19 Online Comedy Fest. My favorite thing to come out of that is your character, Buford T. Violence.
Buford T. Violence. He's inspired by I love drill sergeants, just yelling how they just insult people. So it's kind of all the way back to Full Metal Jacket, that guy. So he just gets angry at people for doing what they're doing. Especially, he'd have a field day on people in the States now trying to. The latest I saw was a man with a sign that said, "Sacrifice the weak." And you're just like, you first.
Yeah, yeah.
You first. Not just the weak of body, weak of mind. Away you go.
How do you think that Buford T. Violence would be responding to being inside all the time?
This is an outrage. I am not happy with what's going on right now. This is not what I signed up for. But I'm going to do it because the tough get going when the going gets tough. Anyway, something like that.
I love Buford. I need more Buford T. Violence in my life, I think.
I'll get on it today.
Now, is there something that you miss? As you sit around the house, is there something that you miss? Because like you, I spend a lot of time at home.
Well, for me, the first thing that I missed was I play pickup hockey like 4 or 5 times a week, and that's my fitness. So I'm not able to do that at all, and that I miss the camaraderie and the stupid jokes in the dressing room and the naked men. So that I'm missing. When you say, oh, you know what, I need Allen keys. And then you're just like, how can I accomplish this incredible feat of finding Allen keys at this time? You know, and it just seems ridiculous that, those kind of things bother me. Most of the time I write, I'm working on a new novel, and I've been trying to do that every day. You know, it's kind of like a muscle you have to exercise every day. So I've been forced to do that, to fill my time, and watching a lot of Netflix. Watching a lot of movies.
Is there anything that you loved that was a surprise to you?
But I watched Underwater last night.
Stewart.
Yes, and she was good in it, I thought.
She runs down a lot of very wet, dripping hallways. I was concerned she was going to fall. Trip, slip, and fall the entire time.
She's a tiny little woman, and I was worried about her in the intense pressure 7 miles underneath the ocean.
That's right.
Yeah, that I worry for her. And have you seen The Man Who Killed Hitler and then The Bigfoot yet?
No, I have not. But I hear it's tremendous. I thought it was a joke when I first heard it. And I think I responded to you on Twitter about it. And you said, oh, you got to watch it. And then I went around to some of my film critic friends and said, have you ever heard of this thing? And they all said, it's so good.
It's really intriguing, and what's great about it is it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But it's really well done, and the acting is amazing.
Well, Sam Elliott's in it, right?
Yeah, he's incredible. And there's a scene, there's a love story, like his love interest, it's so sad and moving. Like, it's incredible. Like, I was just like, wow. What is this doing in this movie? I don't even know what's going on, but it was good. It was excellent. Although my choice, if the only person who could kill the Bigfoot is a man who killed Hitler, probably.
In the before time, you would spend a lot of time on the road. You would be traveling, crossing the country. Do you think when all this is said and done, that the next time you go to get on a plane, that you're going to feel differently about it? Do you think that it will change your thinking about doing the amount of travel that you would have done before?
Well, yeah. I mean, I always have I don't get sick very much. And I've always felt, you know, there's part of me that has always thought that we really protect our kids to a dense degree and sanitize them and everything like that. And it kind of leaves them open to infections and things that are like COVID-19. You know, these are things that are a result of our helicopter kind of approach. But I've always thought that planes were filthy and ridiculous. And you're all sealed in there with everyone's farts and spit and coughs and babies pooping on the floor and everything like that. It's not really, and then they jam you in together. It's like it's gotten closer and closer. But I just think back, you know, every culture and every generation goes through its thing. And with me, I think growing up was smoking. My father smoked like an animal, and he would take us into the car, and we'd go to, getting ready to go to hockey practice in the morning, roll up all the windows in the freezing cold, and then sit there and smoke four or five cigarettes while the car warmed up.
Yep.
You'd go to, like when I went back to London a few years ago to do comedy shows, I went into the clubs and everyone was smoking, and I was like, this is crazy.
It's so weird when you see people smoke inside now in public, isn't it?
No, when you see like a, or you're on a plane and you see it's an old plane and it's got ashtrays in the head and the armrest. Like, I just can't imagine it. And even when they had a smoking section, it was just like those seats you smoke in.
Yeah.
But the entire thing is sealed.
Yeah. And those seats were kind of always sort of in the middle, as I remember. So the people sitting in front of you and in back of you were still getting it.
And people smoking in restaurants, and like, it was crazy. But I mean, viruses are the new thing, you know, and I don't think this will be the last one. You know, how we deal with this will hopefully give us protocols for how do we deal with the future. But yeah, just traveling all together, being around other people, it's going to be interesting to see how people, if people come back to live performance, if they go to concerts, if they go to sporting events, and what will there be an immediate return to it, or will people slowly have to be coaxed back? You know,
people want to be entertained. And yes. I think that there will come a point, and it might not be straight away, but once all this is said and done, that people will maybe go to a comedy show, but they'll bring their mask along with them, you know, and wear a mask or something in the early stages.
Well, people are social animals. You know, you could watch movies at home, but there are cinemas and people fill them. Comedy, what I do, it's all about living in this moment. It's a conversation, and it's really hard to, like, I'm hoping, like, especially in this time when, if you have an album, say, or for musicians, comedians, people who perform live, the only experience that can't be stolen online is, say, Broadway musicals, and live people can tape you as you're doing your stand-up, but it's not the same. The only way performers are making money now is by going around with a bag, town to town, like they used to in medieval times, and saying, did you like the show? Give me money. And going home, you know, you don't make royalties anymore the way you used to. You don't, get album sales, and then you get a percentage of that, and you're, like, if you're not Katy Perry, you're not making any money, you know?
The twins mostly do stuff here.
Wow, did you little mushroom heads make this? A bouncy chair!
Whoa, it looks like a nanny cup.
You guys are like little baby Albert Einsteins, but with weirder hair. What are your names?
Lever.
That's Barnaby.
And that's Barnaby.
Both of you?
Perfect.
Okay. What if I call you Barnaby A?
Do it.
And you're Barnaby B.
Never.
I could tell them apart now.
I like B.
I like A.
You have a movie out.
Weird.
The Willoughbys. There's a couple of things about this. Just before we were to start here, I got an email, and the Willoughbys has all kinds of cool stuff that are online. And this, I don't know if you've seen this or not. This came in from Netflix. I don't know if you can see it, but it's How to Draw the Barnabys. And it is a little illustration on how to draw the two characters that you play, the twins, the Barnabys. And you're also part of their coloring book that they have. And it's like a coloring pages. I don't know if it's a book. But I'll send it to you after this is over. It just came in as we were starting. And your characters are part of this. Have you ever been in a coloring book before?
Never been in a coloring book. I haven't really been in. It's really amazing. Memorabilia I've ever been in was the show called Almost Naked Animals, and they made a few mock-up dolls of one of the, and I got one of them for a Piggy the chef, so I have that. But it's crazy. It's amazing to be involved in something like that. But they're very smart. The people who are running it, it's called Braun Entertainment. And Ricky Gervais is an executive producer. It's really fun, and it's a strange film. Like, it's a strange story about these kids who are a family, the Willoughbys, and they live in this kind of museum almost. And they decide that they could probably raise themselves better than their parents could do it. So they arrange for their parents to go away on an extended trip and then are alone in the house. And it's about, it's really fun. It's
well, they're kind of hoping that their parents die while they're away as well. They have.
I'm not supposed to dwell on that in these interviews.
Okay, I won't. I won't mention it. But I loved it because the animation is eye-popping. It's a really cool-looking movie. The characters are a lot of fun. The voice work, it's Martin Short, it's you, it's Will Forte, it's all kinds of interesting people there. But it's kind of got a little dark edge to it. And I love that because I have often thought that so much kids' entertainment plays it so safe. I don't think that we trust that kids can take a little dark humor.
Well, what I love in the shows that I love are, in the films, are like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang and Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Roald Dahl, dark stories. And I think kids love to see children on their own, left to their own devices, overcoming these different stupid adults, you know, who put them in these terrible situations. I think kids can handle a lot more of that than we let on. And, you know, there's sweet stories like, you know, Moana or whatever like that, but they're always like their parents died or they're alone.
That's right.
You know, it's the weird thing about Disney is like, oh, mom died in the first reel. And now she's, you know, Bambi's living on her own. But I think kids can handle a lot more darkness than we give them credit for, you know, and they gravitate to it. Like his Dark Materials, which is another great series I watched, and the books are amazing. And those things, I think, stick with kids so much more, and they end up going back to them as adults. And I think if you make something that children and adults can watch together, and, you know, if you make something like the Willoughbys, it's funny for adults who are watching this situation and know that the archness of the situation, and the kids who are accepting it at face value, it's good and fun for both, you know, and it becomes a classic for that reason.
And you've written a lot of books for kids and YA books, I guess the young adult books. And you have that same kind of feel. I love in Hamish X Goes to Providence, Rhode Island. There's the Orphan Disposal Agency, the ODA.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're the villain in the piece, and they're these people who take children who are unwanted and unloved and repurpose them for, you know, to get them work for people who are unscrupulous employers and people who need children with small hands to do difficult work. And the ODA is also this, but it exists all over the world, and they're very evil people. And Hamish X and his friends have to overcome them in the books.
And the Willoughbys, you play twins, you play the youngest of the Willoughby clan. There's the Jane and Tim, the older kids. And then they, by the time the parents, who aren't very nice people, finally get around to having twins, they don't even bother to give them separate names. They just call them the Barnabys, which I thought was very funny.
Well, they're very funny, and they're kind of, we recorded them, of course, at the same time, and they make noises. They kind of run around in the background. They're always doing something. They're little kind of inventors. And Chris Pern, who is the director and the mind behind the whole thing, he and I worked together on Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, the series. And so he tapped me to do these brothers because we did weird, the Meatballs is a very weird property as well. So he has a great sense of humor, and a lot of that kind of weird quirkiness is his mind. And the Barnabys are kind of a great manifestation of that. They're the youngest. They only have one sweater. They share back and forth. They build Zeppelins. They're constantly muttering. I kind of love that. I love doing that.
And you're just in a studio by yourself with a director on the other side of the other side of the glass. I always think that it feels, as an actor, that it might be really kind of disconnected because there's no other actors to play off of. How do you work around that?
Well, you'd have to have great editors for these sort of projects. The editor is a real king of that. And the speed of it and the timing, you have to trust the editors are going to be there. And that's why Chris is great, because he's in there at the editing process, and he's going to make sure it's tight enough and it's funny and works. But I had to do all by myself because the cast is so like Will Forte and Maya Rudolph and Terry Crews, and they're all doing lots of things. So you can't get them all in one studio to record for days on end. So you're going to do it separately. And so you just have to kind of imagine you're talking to people. This was more easy because they don't engage with people. People don't have long conversations with the Barnabys. They just kind of make noises and interject and cause trouble. And so they're kind of their own entity. They talk to each other. They don't really talk to other people. So it's a little easier that way. But I prefer when we get on something like Meatballs, we were all in the room together and we have that kind of improvisational, right. We could improvise and then the animation would come afterwards. And so that was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Animation. I always thought that there'd be no room for improv because it is so rigid, but apparently you can have fun with it.
Well, it's fun. I think in the old days it was all about the artists, and it is, I mean, a big part of it is about the artists. People are drawing it, but now with computer animation and flash animation, a lot of the time we do the recording beforehand and then the animation is matched, and then they come back and say we need this dialogue, and then we add it. So it's not like, and I've always been annoyed by, first of all, Mrs. Doubtfire is a ridiculous movie that makes no sense, but the very beginning of Mrs. Doubtfire shows Robin Williams in a recording studio voicing a cartoon, and he's watching the cartoon and then adding in his own things and ad-libbing and getting in trouble for it. And you're like, this never happens. Like, this isn't the process. It would never happen this way. And everything about Mrs. Doubtfire never would happen this way. I mean, you know, if you know anything about makeup and you're like, he's running into the bathroom and then doing full prosthetic makeup on himself and then coming out in 5 minutes. It makes no sense to me, but he's a charming and beloved performer.
So last question, what do you think the effect of the pandemic will be on the kind of entertainment that we want after this? Do you think that there will be humor that comes out of this? Do you think that movies might have a different feel to them? What do you think will happen?
Well, it's funny, you know, you're watching films now and you're like, look at how close they are to each other. And you're watching a television series and you're like, what are you doing? they're congregating.
They're hugging. And
it's so weird. I don't know. Like, I can't tell if it's going to color the way we look at life. And so, I mean, movies are a mirror of life. And will we see a bunch of, quote, this kind of claustrophobic, isolationist kind of stories that we're trying to sell? You know, it was like watching Underwater. I was like, oh, this is a good COVID-19 movie. They're suits and they can't breathe water and they're, you know. But I don't know. I think we're going to see a change in storytelling and the manner of it and what's acceptable and what's interesting to people, because people have lived through a war, you know, and that makes a huge impression on people's minds and their imaginations as well.
Sean, thanks so much for doing this.
It's a real pleasure.
Yeah. Nice to see you. And you know, I hope that you're back playing hockey sooner rather than later.
I hope you're out watching movies.
Me too. I will go to the theaters. I will go to the theaters. But can you imagine being that person? So the new James Bond movie opens, we all go, and then you're that person that coughs really loudly in the front, and the other 599 people turn to glare at you?
Well, go to VIP theaters and sit very alone in your big armchair. It's good.
I will.
Well, that was Sean Cullen. See him in The Willoughbys. You'll find him on Netflix. And then when all this is said and done, go see him perform live. I guarantee you, it is a comedy show unlike you've never seen before. His mind works at warp speed. And it's hard to keep up sometimes, but I'll tell you one thing, you will laugh. I guarantee that. Now, Sean and I were talking at the end of that interview about going back to the movies, and it made me wonder, how many of you watching will be rushing back to the movie theaters when they reopen, whenever that is? Will you feel comfortable sitting next to somebody? Will you feel uncomfortable if somebody coughs in the front row? Let me know. Either leave a comment on the comment section down below this video on YouTube, or get in touch with me on Twitter. That's at Richard Krause. While you're on Twitter, check out Sean's COVID-19 Online Comedy Fest. Just use that hashtag. And again, if we're sitting inside trying to fill up the minutes of the day, I guarantee you, you'll laugh. He's a funny man. Thanks so much for watching. Stay home, stay healthy, and we'll talk to you again soon.